I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Haggan, Nigel Haggan.
Yeah.
He is a very, we know each other a lot, so this I'm not going to use this section. Have you read this? I hope you read it through the announcement, right? Nigel has some interesting background, starting off from Belfast and walking his way to Canada. Did you walk or did you take
the... For the first time I came, I took a boat because my father said if I flew, I'd have no idea the size of the world.
Uh-huh, there you go. Not because of climate change, okay?
It was cheaper. It was cheaper to take a boat in those days, too.
Yeah, in those days, so you have time. It's more like now with internet. So anyway, so Nigel is a very special person in many ways. Actually, he graduated here, his PhD. He got his PhD from our lab, actually. And not only that, this building here, I think Nigel is one of the key people we need to thank for having this place. He was executive director of the Fisheries Center when we applied for this. It was central to really putting the proposal together, getting all the people, and getting us the money to build this place. So,
slight correction. I was the executive director for a while, but the faculty rose up muttering among themselves because they felt that the executive director was a higher rank, where I just saw it as a kind of a fairly lowly personage, and I became the executive coordinator.
Yeah.
My friend Tony Pitcher was the then director. We would go and talk all over the place, and he would stand up and say, "I'm Tony Pitcher, I'm the director of the Fisheries Center." And I'd stand up and I'd say, "I'm Nigel Haggan, I'm the brain of the Fisheries Center."
So that was quite a very interesting, stimulating time. So we were in the huts there. Some of you will not even, cannot imagine how it was before we moved here. So thank you for that. And so in terms of academics, Nigel is somebody who tries to bring culture, religion, First Nations into science. That's one of his goals, right?
Yeah.
And I think we will have a bit of that here.
Yeah.
Get to personal. All right. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Rashid, and thank you all for coming, and I appreciate the acknowledgement of the traditional territory. It bothers me when people don't acknowledge the territory. And it bothers me sometimes almost more when they do and then carry on with business that is irrelevant or counter to the interests of the title holders in the territory. But it's a good thing, and I think we all mean that in the spirit. So the title of my talk is Unsettling Fisheries Science, or
look at some of the elements of the yoga, some of the convergent goals with very different
include the form of procurement value. Yeah. So I see the universe as a conversation between matter, space, and time, enabled by dark matter and dark energy, as well, in the same way as the laws of this room make this conversation possible, even though we don't normally think about them. The process of putting some particles through 300 million, million years of creative darkness to the back of the stars, the elements, the planets, in the first life, to the precarity of increasing complexity, people walked out of Africa, and the climate ecology is in. From the Calcatina, or one of its sources, they almost certainly walked out under an elephant road to span the whole continent. Waterhole to waterhole. It's a series of ecological crises. And I went from my dissertation from becoming indigenous. So people who hit new ecologies, either eventually they hit limits. They plunder, perish, or become indigenous. There were thousands of years of conversation between people and animals and plants, lands, waters, and spirits. They formed covenants and treaties with non-humans that are encoded, notably in the first stories of the people of this land, as one of the cultures of Susan Martin wrote, the geopolitics of the Shenzhen, has suggested that they would take the right to character comes back to these ancient relationships. Over thousands of years, the people and the planet and the climate change each other over all recognition, and they formed diverse political, eco-social, spiritual communities. And this is a chunky term, but it does bring in the spiritual as an integrative dimension of experience, rather than a peculiarity or out of acquaintance of charm of our Aboriginal people, as the government tends to refer to it. Some of these communities are sustainable over thousands of years. John Ellington and his colleagues, some of you, documents 8 to 10,000 years of sustainability in the Channel Islands of California. One species went extinct, and that was a flightless duck. And the evidence suggests that they didn't eat all the flightless ducks, but that somebody thought it was a good idea to bring one of the islands, or one of the foxes over onto the islands. The evidence suggests that the foxes ate all the flightless ducks. Ron Foster, who was my co-supervisor in my PhD at the University of Arizona, outlined principles that contributed to at least 2,000 years of sustainability of this coast. Now, not suggesting by any manner or means that all Aboriginal societies were or are sustainable, but I do think that we need to pay significant attention to those that were and that still are, and what the underpinnings of those societies were. So what went wrong? Enlightenment science saw the belief in spirits as primitive superstition. Missing Christianity had more trouble with the idea of spirits, but they perceived all spirits apart from the one true spirit up there as idolatrous. So spiritual beings lost their status as personhood and in a lot of the Aboriginal societies as elders who were there before them and who were more or less potent within the land, becoming commodities, leading to all the kind of stuff that we have now. Our friend Dr. Deep had this commissioned picture of what's happening in the sea. Deep is on your phone. Used to refer to the Greek as the great deep, but I thought Dr. Deep would have some more respectful. Anyway, Pillburgers got to the restaurant near here. Actually, I think that beyond the bonus beef burger is probably going to come, at least as before the Pillburger, so close. In our time, boundary limits put us in exactly the same peril our ancient ancestors. But we have no next valley to exploit or plunder, while the face of our friend Tony Pitcher. Spiritual, religious, and aesthetic considerations are excluded from environment common language to negotiate peace or covenants with non-humans. In no way to extend moral consideration to non-humans. So this picture, I'm sure you see this by specimen, tells sort of the intellectual limits that we're having some trouble with at the moment. So, as I put it, need and love collide. We need the goods and services, but we love them too. And government is measurement, monitoring, surveillance, and control. It's no wonder it loves in the politics. Try any of that language from anybody or anything that you want to see how far it gets you. Citizens bring the language of love and relationship to the things like pipeline project. Each of the spiritualities of others and the people draw a powerful response. But, and now I'm going to give you a few words from my friend Tim Michelle, who I turned to a member of the Fish Talk Nation. Tim and I kind of like the two old guys in the market show. Nothing really enthusiastic. But, for some reason, that's not the stuff he regards me as his elder. And in some ways, I'll freeze my conscience because at night we're talking with you. In the presence of commercial guys at 50 times a week, or at least the way that person says, try to reach him in that sentence. That's kind of a fun exercise. Anyway, this is Tim. Aboriginal people are allowed to put speech on letters. Unfortunately, that's all they're allowed to talk about. So the form of censorship is, you, we can trust you out. Do your little song and dance. Say your little prayer. And now get along and have it before you can say. So that whole concept of power has censorship is used by saying, you are allowed to participate in creating knowledge. The only thing is through window dressing so we can validate that we actually connected with an Aboriginal person. And it gets to be this whole thing about those poor Indians, look what happened there. And that doesn't do anybody one pretty good. Aboriginal people are allowed. Of course, you're not allowed to do it. Anyway, sacred is sneaking back in for the resource management. The Yale Forum on Religion and Ecology has produced 9 poems on the relationship of the world and the world of religions to ecology, and it's in a very seminal manner, 100 pages long, so there's a bit of reading there for you guys. But powerful statements from religious and scientific leaders. The Millennium Extinction Assessment and a lot of the ecological economic literature, including at least one paper from my friend Rashid, talks about how the sacred, moral, and spiritual are as much or more important many people as the material. And in my research presentation, I said, who are these men? Who are these others? And defined with a fifth about everybody in the planet as a spiritual connection one way or another, but they're very differently expressed. There are 2 major responses to this literature. The first I describe is funk and spook, where you fight the millennials in the system assessment. Approval, and then go back to your coping of economic values. And the other one is to tell stories of the spiritual values sustained in the most dramatic places. It's not hard for government to believe that the spiritual beliefs of the Haggan nation and the Unsettling nation contributed to thousands of years of sustainable use, but they failed to see the numbers. And the states of Vancouver or London or Paris or New York. Here's just a few. This on the left is an exhibit that my wife put on in the Museum of Anthropology with House of Bacchus, recently being made, and it shows Yagis. There's a house of guardian spirits swollen, and of the large crude carrier trespassing in harsh waters. I had to order the plastic crude carrier, and I was just reading that time to call it. Anyway, D.L. Wilson wrote this book called The Creation, wondering why religious leaders didn't give a shit about ecology. And it's kind of interesting that there's a Southern Baptist Declaration of Climate Change is almost an answer to that. They may well speak by any manner against the law of Southern Baptists, but they do say something like, we don't approach climate change with the certainty that we ascribe to Holy Scripture. Nevertheless, we see science as a revelation for our time, and we need to pay attention to it. We cannot afford to ignore it. Pope Francis, in particular, like others, see that they wrote just before the Paris Conference of Climate Change led to the accord. Apparently, it was quite influential with great many countries who are predominantly Catholic and contributing materially to that accord. However, Einstein distinguished science and religion. In fact, he said, science can tell you a great deal about what is, but absolutely nothing about what should be. And the Stevie J. Gould jumped in then and formulated this dogma of non-overlapping magisteria, whereby science and religion can have civil conversations across the fence, provided they don't try and answer each other's questions. And the environmental scientists do have a dilemma. If they adopt a religious or spiritual stance, they worry about being discredited through advocacy. The other peril is that if you don't do something, then you leave more moralizing to the moralists, and that's not really a very good idea. Einstein added that religion without science is blind, and science without religion is lame. So Gould's magisteria, however helpful it might be in exploring the cosmos from the Big Bang or exploring some kind of particles, are not particularly useful in the world of existing best management. I thought a mixed magisteria over is and should provide. We have impact assessment, existing best management response to climate change. What is? Science can tell us a great deal about it. What should be religion? Well, actually, maybe more of an influence in that modest line would suggest, but when you get to the community level, or when you get to the kind of stuff that you guys are wrestling with, you need to know something about what you're working with in order to know how you should deal with it. So I don't find Bruce speaking particularly useful, at least in the world that we live in. Mind you, there's a lot of other people. Anyway, I searched a few slides here for my friend Andrea Frank, who made a presentation here in 2008, talking about some of the things, but the role of moral sentiments. Alvin Leopold. Anybody here hasn't heard of Alvin Leopold? The scientists want to talk about right and wrong. They almost invariably cite Alvin Leopold. Leopold's a prophet of ecology who said that anything that contributes to the flourishing of the biotic community is right, and anything that detracts from it is wrong. So he's providing some authority or some ground to stand on. Darwin, the role of the emotions. It's not possible to give an adequate idea of the higher feelings of wonder, admiration, and devotion which go and elevate the mind. And she talks about her sacred, or she quotes Mercia Ariad. Privileged places, qualitatively different from all others. This is not the sense of language. A man's birthplace, or the scenes of his first love, certain places in the first forest that he visits and receives. Even for the most frank, non-religious person, all these places do retain an exceptional unique quality. They are the holy places of his private universe. I put that in bold, as if were in such spots that he has received the revelation of a reality other than that which he experiences in daily life. Picking up from Andrea, the holy places of his own separation of religion and politics was never intended to keep the insights of the larger religious and spiritual traditions out of the public square. But it was used very effectively to do so. It was over and misinterpreted in my view. Jack Caputo's corollary said, religion is a room thing in the academy. All of you, many of you have the temerity to bring up religion of science, you probably met with withering storm, with the worship of Pope Thomas. His theology, incidentally, is incredible. He can't distinguish the creative flow of the universe from the old white guy. Anyway, what's the point? Hundreds of people born with social license to speak. I've been in many, many meetings over the years on farm and other things that are problematic. The discussion goes on and an Aboriginal person stands up and says, it's a spiritual matter. And almost immediately afterwards, all kinds of non-Aboriginal people jump up and say, you know, he's right. It is a spiritual matter. But without that person breaking the ice, they would not have said that. At best, we follow their lead. I remember being at a meeting on Hendricks in the basement of Christchurch Cathedral, and we were talking about Hendricks, and somebody said, well, we should defer to the Aboriginal people in this. Aboriginal person said, oh, yes, defer to the Aboriginal people. I said, you know, with the greatest respect, I could not disagree with you more. Aboriginal people, for far too long, have been the sole voice for our spiritual connection to this beautiful place. Got to stop hiding behind and putting forward as human skills because we're not prepared to express our own spiritual attachment, which I would argue, obviously not as bold or as deep or as blunt as the spiritual wisdom of the people who are still in touch with their traditional qualities. But the attachment we have to our own sacred places, to our gardens, I think is not qualitatively different. There's an epistemic of cognitive injustice where Aboriginal spiritual people are welcomed in the corridors of power, industry, and the economy. Used to set the tone for conferences, Olympics, etc. Not welcome in the first place where spirituality does not belong. Those who do belong, such as ourselves, may not use the language of love, relationship, religion, or spirituality in our work. It's a double-edged cognitive injustice. As my friend Bobby Joe, aka Chief Prophet, Joseph, who was instrumental in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and very much a part of our pipeline to the bullets of this project. I was having breakfast with him about 3 years ago, and he said, you'll never guess where I'm going next, my friend. And I said, tell me. And I'm going back to Vancouver Club to talk to the CEOs of all the mining companies in British Columbia. And I said, oh yeah, maybe try listening. Ask them how it is that only as an Aboriginal person that you would be invited into their company to talk of spiritual matters, whereas they, who no doubt have deep spiritual attachment to their own sacred spaces, may well, at some level, be uneasy about what some of their projects are doing to the environment, are not allowed to speak of it. I don't know if we can do it or not. Anyway, it's called for creative justice as a way called for creative justice as reuniting those separated by forces outside their control. Now, Tillich was talking about people and God, but I really liked that idea of creative justice and used it in a paper in the BC Fishery where we had Aboriginal people, commercial fishers, sport fishers, and environmentalists who are not natural enemies, but have frequently been put in each other's throats by the politics of scarcity and creative justice. Tony Joseph, Nigel, Nigel, go from what they just talked about. The relationship between science and indigenous knowledge, that indigenous knowledge and how this is knowledge, you know, it's okay. Testimonial justice, right here, not to say somebody that that's either woman or black or aboriginal, and epistemic injustice. And the example that she gives is of a woman suffering from sexual harassment in a culture where the concept does not exist. And I suspect that some of you suffering from a form of deprivation of ability to express your emotional and spiritual attachment in this inner climate of science, where those things don't exist. You may have spiritual beliefs, you may be a religious person, but please don't bring that in here. Keep it for Sunday or wherever you go. Literature speaks of harnessing, capturing, incorporating, integrating. In fact, I put those words into Google Scholar. You got thousands of hits from 2010 to 2020. And these are kind of gasping metaphors of incest. So harnessing's kind of fun. I mean, what's the wagon with science? The wagon is a pretty protective tool. That kind of interrogate metaphors don't come as much fun. Instead, what I would see coming back to that metaphor of conversation are these two different ways of understanding and being the world in the world, being like two people walking eyes across a bar or a party and recognizing that there's somebody there that you really want to meet and to approach. And that's the spirit, I think, in which we need to have a conversation between the different traditions of knowledge and ways of understanding and being in the world. Venus is kind of limited. There's a picture of the longhouse doors by Hester Douglas Bradley, one of my wife's people, I'm sure most of you have seen them. And the beings that English regard as men, the people, the salmon, and the cedar, flow into each other. A lot of Aboriginal languages are verb or process based. And English, you have to use words like seamless to describe the flow of creatures from one thing to another in a blanket. But the indigenous languages have done all our terms like either periodically, periodically, and let go that which translates as all my relations or possibly better, we are all related. And you will hear people say that. And I have always seen it as a blessing of the assembled company that ripples out to encompass the trees, the grass, and all the other creatures and beings we share the world with. Hot black rock, mango yoke, shush, twat, sawak, tamil language, they all mean everything is connected, all we are all one. Anyway, speaking of the new tamils, I'd like to review some of the Aboriginal relationships at the Fisheries Center and the Institute of Ocean Sciences. Somewhere in the late 80s, early 90s, we entered into a memorandum of agreement with the First Nations Longhouse and the BC Aboriginal Fisheries Commission, which then was, to accelerate the recruitment of Aboriginal masters and doctoral students into the position of science, find respective and effective ways of bringing traditional knowledge and the ecosystem of science that we practice within these four worlds together, and with one other thing I can't quite remember. Simon Lucas, some parental chief of the Eskia Nation of the Tamils, is no longer with us. Received an honorary degree from UBC in 1992. A funny picture nominated in America as a high quarterback. We had a conference, so we had 2,000 putting Fisher's knowledge to work in the was a long time ago. It's so long ago that I can't find the document. UBC spent several years of indecision. But they finally did put their hand into their collective pocket and cut off the money through a hard paid choice of a prize commission of the Confederated Tribes of the Mattel. 50-50% shared between science and zoology. David, unfortunately, is no longer with us. Thank you, Rusty, that it's I'm going to share to the four candidates for the current position. All of them emphasize their scientific record and their community connections and research. They responded positively to my plotting on the spiritual dimension of Aboriginal knowledge and how it contributes to sustainability. But I don't think anybody really said how they would go about implementing that. But there's no wonder, given the history of what my friend Tim said, that there are only certain aspects of Aboriginal spirituality that filter into the academy, and it's not a friendly place for spirituality. So, without preempting anything that the new chair might bring to do, it seems to me that the rest of us would start maybe to try and explore our own, how to express our own spiritual and emotional connection to the sea, and how we might bring that into our work so that that conversation would be at least started. And this seminar, actually, I don't know if Jenny misinterpreted what I suggested, but my suggestion was that we start a conversation, sort of like an informal seminar on spirituality, but then he offered me this seminar, so here we are, so I thought I'd talk for a while, and then maybe we can try and see how it might work to start that kind of conversation amongst ourselves. So what can we do? We can develop the concept of the secular sacred that draws on but does not belong any religious or spiritual tradition. Thomas Haggan and Stephen Gould, I think, quarterbacked the 1990 declaration called Preserving the Church of the Earth that was signed by 42 scientists and 270 world religious leaders, in which they call for a concept of our planetary home as sacred. We can also design school and university courses in spirituality and environmental practice. And I have a great big fat tedious document that I developed some years ago, and I would really like some help with that. I think it would be a good thing to do. It would be what I would describe as a piece of harmless mischief. I could work to bring the language of gift and relationship back into environmental practice. So, the words of my sponsors. Now, starting now, this is what I want to do, and this is the conversation that I want to see if we can have. And because of the barriers that I've outlined, might not be that comfortable to start that with one of these four walls to do that. And I don't know whether we could run that as a free discussion or whether divide into groups and discuss these things and talk about anything. I know you're used to being talked to for 40 minutes, so I'm not 40 minutes worth of anything to say. So my friend. Anyway, I talked about Sagan and Gould and that declaration, and two people, Michael Sandel, Margaret Somerville, have gotten the concept of a secular sacred that spans different forms of religion and spirituality without violence to their specificity. The language of commerce has been allowed to extend far beyond its conscious sphere. That, I think, is a problem that we deal with. We talked about fisheries science, but I think what we're actually talking about is fisheries economics and science, because it's science policy economics. The growth of the Department of Fisheries parallels the dawning realization in the settlers' minds that the salmon weren't limitless and inexhaustible. So the Department of Fisheries and Oceans is in fact the major Chinese industry, and for the first many, many, many years, the president of BC Packers, which is the big salmon company, was interchangeable with the director general. That's why we have that entrenched right in the science following the economics. Anyway, I'll just try something on the secular sector before I come back to that exercise. This is what I was thinking. Might be thought of as emergent preventative relations built over the lifetime of individuals and communities. Productive of different ways of understanding and being in the world, rather than as late famous criticizers say in failed attempts at modern modernity. Recognized, not assigned by external barrier, expressed as relationship and belonging, consistent with respectful, generous, and grateful use, but resistant to division, extinction, and damage, resistant to monetary equivalence, evident acknowledgement of our own complicity in the situation we find ourselves in, atonement, commitment to renewal, and getting us signed to the international action of changing the international and could go into 10 minutes. Oh, not legumes in my unit. This is a self-portrait of crap. This is a little bit of personal stuff. I want to come back to these questions. Does anybody want to take a kick at describing what it was that brought you into these four walls?
Thank you. Now, starting now, this is what I wanted to do, and this is the conversation that I want to see if we can have. And because of the barriers that I've outlined, might not be that comfortable to start that within these four walls, but here we are. And I don't know whether we could run that as a free discussion or whether divide into groups and discuss these things and talk about it. What do you think? I know you used to be talked to for 40 minutes, but I don't have 40 minutes worth of anything to say. Come back to that in a minute. Anyway, I talked about Sagan and Gould in that declaration, and other people, Michael Sandel, Margaret Somerville, they're lacking the concept of a secular sacred that spans different forms of religion and spirituality without violence to their specificity. The language of commerce has been allowed to extend far beyond its proper sphere. And that, I think, is the problem that we deal with. We talk about fisheries science, but I think what we're actually talking about is fisheries economics and science, because the science follows the economics. The growth of the Department of Fisheries and Oceans Fisheries as it then was in the Pacific Northwest, parallels the dawning realization in the settlers' minds that the salmon weren't limitless and inexhaustible. So the Department of Fisheries and Oceans is in fact a younger child of industry, and for the first many, many, many years, the president of BC Packers, which is the big salmon company, was interchangeable with the Director General of Fisheries and Oceans. And that's why we have that entrenched bit of the science following the economics. Anyway, I've just tried something on the secular sacred before I come back to that exercise. The this is what I was thinking, might be thought of as emergent from intimate relations built over the lifetime of individuals and communities, productive of different ways of understanding and being in the world, rather than, as Wade Davis never tires of saying, failed attempts at modernity, recognized, not assigned by an external value, or expressed as relationship and belonging, consistent with respectful, generous, and grateful use, but resistant to depletion, extinction, and damage, resistant to monetary equivalence, evident an acknowledgement of our own complicity in the situation we find ourselves in, atonement, commitment, renewal. I'm getting a sign here that I have actually come to the end of my time, right? I could go on. Oh, talking about humans and non-humans, this is a self-portrait of a crab. This is not a bit of personal stuff that I was talking about. I want to come back to these questions. Does anybody want to take a kick at describing what it was that brought you into these four walls?
And spent a few weeks camping in Chinna Bay in Huyat territory, and I found out about invertebrate archaeology program that I could apply for, and so I just had to, because it would mean I could work there. I could work in Barkley Sound and in Banfield and with the Huyat Nation, so I just completely switched paths.
Yeah, so how would you describe that? You describe that as calls? Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I have this. Anybody else? Yeah.
I'm not pretty sure if it's a kind of like personal encounter, but when I was like watching video, and it's a kind of, it kind of shows kind of voice of a whale that is in the ocean, and it's like the voice from the sky or from the heavens, something like that. And I think it's a kind of, also a kind of call, but it's a kind of call from the nature, from other creatures that are different from us, but it's like, I feel like they're kind of different from us, but also like, in a way, they're like living in another world and also connect to us in a different, in a very, very close way, something like that. And I found that kind of attracted to this ocean
and some studies. Yeah, so do you find that connection that you felt, that you can explore it through your studies, or is it something that exists and keeps you going in spite of some of the stuff that you have to go through?
Yeah, I think it's like, it calls me to explore
this. Go ahead. Sorry, somebody. Oh, I thought somebody had their hand up. I had this sort of parable about, say, a young woman in BC encounters a sockeye salmon and is absolutely fascinated by this beautiful creature, so much so that she wants to spend her life, as you say, in these places with these creatures. So she goes to school to learn about them. And the first thing that happens is that this creature that spoke to her, and it's that absolute particularity and its uniqueness out of the context of the wind, the weather, the sun, the love of the friends or relatives that was with her. When you put it into a classification system, it becomes identical to all other sockeye salmon. Get into an ecological model, becomes a box, and the model into a bioeconomic model. It becomes becomes exchangeable through market price for other goods and services. And you learn how to do all these things. She learns how to do all these things because she wants to spend her life in these places with these people. But the tragedy is that by the time she gets there, the language in which she learned about the things that she loves doesn't allow her to love them. And it's certainly not the money that keeps the marine scientists that I know at their computers far into the night. It's that passionate commitment to the creatures and people of the sea, the desire to see something work better.
Yeah, this actually deeply resonates, and I think that concept of a need for a relationship and getting out of the individual mindset more to a communal mindset, not just with each other, but also with the places and the creatures that we know, and that concept of community in the more general sense is really important. And I don't know where we start with that, though, so I guess, I mean, I think it's great, this notion of having conversations and starting there, but is there any other place we think we can start integrating that?
Not that comes immediately to mind, though there should be lots.
Structurally, that could help facilitate that, because at least I came from a smaller anthropological department to this quite large interdisciplinary department, and it seems like you can go so long without interacting with people sometimes. It kind of feels siloed sometimes.
Yeah.
And I'm lucky that I'm in a very supportive and warm lab, but I feel like if that wasn't the case, I would feel very lonely.
Fair enough. Well, as I say, I'm offering to facilitate an informal seminar once a month or whatever, where people can start to explore how to do exactly what you're talking about, which is, you know, when there's a climate of safety to express what really matters to you, and to say, you know, if there's something in your work that you feel that you really would like to be able to deal with this, but you can't because the metrics and methods don't allow for it. This book, Extraordinary Anthropology, is really worth reading because in it anthropologists describe their encounters with things that cannot happen in the Western scientific paradigm and the jeopardy that it puts them in ethically. The inability to report on something that is tremendously important to the communities, part of the lived world of the communities that have taken them in and shared their knowledge with them. And also that climate of withering scorn that attracts any mention of religion in the academy. My friend Dr. Deep comes to mind. I mentioned him obliquely in the book chapter and Rose Bolson. Rashid, what's the name of Rosemary's book?
Just Fish?
No, the one after. Anyway, it doesn't matter, but what I said is that even the most anti-religious fisheries scientist might be considered as a love of God, the creator, or Allah, however you see the creative flow of the universe for fish. And I believe that. I believe that it's love that drives the work that we do, and that the tragedy is that we don't have the means to express it. I think we need to restore that.
So, Nigel, here is my question.
Yes.
Do you think there is any good reason why Western scientific practice doesn't want to touch religion? Do you think there's any good reason?
There are many reasons, because of the record of religions, as you know, is not stellar. You don't have to tell a boy from Belfast about the problems that bad religion can create, but I think that there's a lot of eco-theology and eco-feminist theology that is really very, very liberating. And I think we have to get past that because, you know, you almost have Richard Dawkins in the Enlightenment, God playing, I'm the king of the castle and you're the dirty rascal, that the laws of religion and the laws of science are at war, but there are no laws of religion, and even some of the physicists say that the laws of science are nothing more than deeply ingrained habits. You know, it's a conflict that has no need to be. But it's very easy to bring up a lot of problems and say, no, we're not prepared to admit this here because religion inappropriate in a pluralistic society.
Mm. Okay, Nigel. Yes, we're at the end of it, right? I can see Catherine looking at me. So thank you for this. This is special for this group. We love our data, we love our morals, but this is, this is different, okay? Let's give him a hand.